It's Teams on 10, huge show, smooth Cat Mitch Duncan is on. Do players need to be role models? We get stuck into that. And Craig McRae, he's a relationship coach. We discuss what that is. Yes, it is Teams on 10. Nick Butler alongside the former Blue and Giant. And now he's like a cross between the sixth Beatle and Frodo. What are you doing with the old Fred Astaire, my boy? Honestly, are you going the Beatle?
No, I'm not going that look. Now, Nick, we are in a lockdown at the moment.
Yes.
And one of those things that you can't do in lockdown is get a haircut.
No.
So I do apologise for this. It is quite offensive, and I keep getting told how ugly I am and how much I look
no,
like Frodo.
No, you're not
tonight,
ugly.
So. No, I'm sorry. I'm ugly. I'm sorry.
You look like a beetle. It's great. You can't buy me love. You can't buy me love.
Let's
right move on. Into it. Juices.
Juices. Big week of footy. This week, thanks to Bay Juice, really got me thinking previously about Port. Now, their show on the weekend was unbelievable against the Cats. I loved them.
Yep.
And it got me thinking back to 2012 when I was playing football and my debut was against Port
at
Amy Stadium.
Right.
And it got me thinking back to thinking how bad it was playing against Port. They were playing at stadiums. They were empty. They were putting tarps over seats. They couldn't get anyone to go out to their games at all. Fast forward 8-9 years later, they're at Adelaide Oval, sorry. They've got In Excess, Never Tear Us Apart. Obviously one of the best on-game experiences, and the crowd absolutely love it. And you just got to give a big shout-out to them for their 180 they've been able to do. It's been unbelievable how that club has turned themselves around in that short amount of time and become the cool club in Adelaide.
I was about to say, it's an amazing marketing turnaround. The kids love it. Their merch is good.
But even the redesign of the jumper.
Even the Bogans look good in it.
Well, the redesign of the jumper was another one. Something really smart happened there. I wasn't sure if it was David Koch. I know he's a big fan of the show. We might have to get him on one day. But they've done some very, very good things there. So a big shout out to Port. And I am on them hard going into the final series.
That's a very good juice.
Now, thank you, sir.
Mine. I talk about mourning mummy because mummy's coming towards the end.
That's
and
weird.
I said Sam Draper is kind of filling
yep.
the void. Well, I found another one.
Mm-hmm.
And his name is Luke Jackson from the D's, right? He's a big boy. He plays with presence. I like my big men tough. I don't like him like going for cheap kicks and mucking around and worrying about foot skills. So he can take hangers, right?
Huge.
He's got forward craft. Look at that. You just know he's around. But if I didn't love him already, when he lost a fang with a bit of friendly fire, so he got a fang knocked out. I thought, oh, is he tough? Is my boy tough like mummy? And then he decided to go and make a joke about it. Let's have a listen to Luke Jackson.
Make sure you wear your mouth guard, kids, because you don't want to look like this.
We love that. That's great.
He's making gags. If I lost my two front fangs, I'm not playing again this year.
Hey, just on this, I really respect Melbourne for this. They've been shown in the past to have made some pretty interesting calls when it comes to players picked up that haven't really worked out. You look at Tom Scully, Jack Trengrove, Luke Tapscott, a few players like this. For them to double down and pick up a ruckman high in the draft, I was questionable of this pick for them and if they really needed it, having Max Gawn being the number one ruck in the comp. And hasn't it just come back and absolutely benefit them massively.
And he's so young. Like, normally big fellas don't come good till about 23, 24, but he's taking hangers now, got the presence playing like a man already. They've got a beauty.
Yeah,
I love him.
Impressive.
So, mummy, you can just move on into the sunset because I love Luke Jackson now.
Well, he's a Neds level youngster, but someone else that's caught my eye and is actually a good friend of mine is Jake Stein.
Oh,
is Jake Stein? Jake Stein.
Giant.
I'm going another giant this week. I think it's three
goodness.
Weeks in a row. But this young man, he's not so young. I think he's nearly about 30. But he actually was a decathlon athlete in the Commonwealth Games a few years ago. And to be honest, and he'd be the first person to say this, was nowhere near getting a game, was playing twos, he was stuck in quarantine and things weren't going his way. But it shows you how quickly in life things can turn around. He's found himself in the team. On the weekend, had 11 disposals in the first quarter and 5 intercept possessions. Now, we only went on to have 3 touches after that, but that's not important. It's just an incredible turnaround. And this week is my Neds level youngster. Taking his game to the Neds level is incredible.
It Steen or Stein?
Technically, it is Jake Steen, but
right.
he prefers Stein.
Well, if I've got to call the game next year...
Stein.
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 He's a bit Alira-Lear-ish, is he? He's an interceptor.
Well, he wasn't until this week, and it shows how much confidence can back you in, and the big stage builds players. He was a lockdown, shutdown defender, but it just shows after one match of being able to put yourself in the right position, backing yourself in, who knows what's next for him. So massive shout-out to him, and massive shout-out to Neds. It's been the favourite segment of the year, I think.
Well, it has been, but there's been one problem with it. And I've had a bit of DM email work. Yeah. One of my staff alerted me to this.
I'm sure
and they
you
said,
have.
Nick, we've had some correspondence.
Yeah.
We've had a viewer complaint. I said, what did Dill do?
Well, that's something I actually do believe.
Well,
that we've
apparently
had
you're ruining the segment because you pick Giants every week. Roll the videotape, please.
This one is Sam Taylor, and I've been on this man for a long time. My Neds level youngster, who is a little bit like this in a few years, who I reckon will be a star thanks to Neds, is Tanner Bruin from the Giants. I think this Giants bias is coming out to us thanks to the legends at Neds, and this player and this man is taking his game to the Neds level. It's Connor Iden from the Giants. Wow.
You are ruining the segment.
Yeah, that's
and
fair.
Neds are allowing us to be here. They're paying for these lights and these very talented people we have working
for us. I can't tell the Giants to stop taking
their
game to the Neds level. I can't go out there and tell them to stop doing it. I can maybe start overlooking them, but until some other players put their hands up, I don't know what to do.
We will continue this conversation. We might have to get Tomo in if you keep this up because Tomo just does what he's told to do. Hey, time for a break. We've got another Giant to talk about after the break. Toby, he's a great footballer. Does he need to be a role model? Can't he just play like a devil and muck up occasionally? We'll discuss that after the break. Teams on 10 is proudly brought to you by Furphy Refreshing Ale. Unbelievable.
Good afternoon, everybody. And today we are very pleased to announce Craig McRae has been appointed the senior coach of the Collingwood Football Club.
Yeah, I'm pretty pumped. Let's face it, this is a significant part of my journey and it's been a long one.
There he is, the Fly, Craig McRae, the new Magpies coach, one of footy's good blokes, been a really handy player. Mm. You would have remembered him even though you're a young fella.
Yeah, definitely.
15-year apprenticeship, worked under Hardwick, worked under Clarkson. The thing when you discuss Craig McRae's coaching, it always comes back to him being a relationship coach. He builds relationships with players, whatever that means.
Yeah.
He gets their trust and he tends to be able to get the best out of them. Let's just hear from him today about how he goes about building those relationships.
I just respect everybody the same, regardless of your status in the game or your background. I don't particularly care. I'll treat the property steward as much as the same way I treat Mark.
So that's his MO. No ego, treat everyone the same. It works really well as an assistant coach. How's he going to go as a senior coach? Can you be everyone's mate?
Oh, look, I think what he said there is great. He's going to respect everyone and everyone's on an equal playing field, which is exactly what you want on a playing list. But you're right, that's the thing that I see is it's very easy to be very chummy with players and a relationship coach when you're assistant because the final buck doesn't fall with you. It falls with the senior coach. And I think your motto and your the mentality, the way that you change when you are the senior coach is going to be very different. So it'll be interesting to see how it all works. I think he's going to be an awesome coach. I think he was a great fit. And like you said, I grew up watching Craig McRae for the Lions and absolutely loved him. And to think that his apprenticeship has been as long as it has, it's going to hold him in great light to take over the Pies. And I like the fact, just on that lastly, that the last two coaches of the Pies have been some incredibly big, big characters and not egotistical characters at all in any means, but just big names. Malthouse, Nathan Buckley. Craig McRae just seems to bring a bit of a calming action to that. Do you agree?
Yeah, I covered it today. There was some jokes made that when Bucks got the job, he got out of a Lexus and there were smoke machines and pretty similar with Mick and poor old Fly just got a Zoom with like a shaky audio. But he didn't care. He goes, that's me. Yeah. And he made a gag that it was in Nathan Buckley's polo shirt that he'd left because the pecs are a bit big. So he does look like a good fella. And I think he's come... he played his footy under Robert Walls and Lee Matthews. So he would have had tough love himself. I don't think he's going to be a pushover. But can I just ask you about the... I'm a bit older than you, and relationships didn't really come into it when I was playing footy. It must be important now. Collingwood wanted a guy that can build strong relationships with players. So guys coming through now, they obviously want to be the coaches, maybe not so much mate, but have a fatherly relationship.
It's interesting. I'm a little bit like yourself, and by no means was I picked in the team every week, but I never wanted to be best friends with a coach. I don't think players want to be best mates with a coach. All they want is respect and honesty. They're the two things you want as a player, is respect and honesty. And that's all you need. So as long as the relationship is built on respect and honesty and not trying to be your best friend and telling you things that aren't true, that's when the lines can get blurred. So I think Craig will do a great job as long as he's honest, and I'm sure he will be. The Pies are in a really good spot, so I'm really excited for him.
They reckon he was the footy trip organiser and the Mad Monday organiser. Would you be admitting that to the boys or just trying to erase that from the resume?
I think he'll be erasing that one very quickly.
Righto. So good luck to the Fly and good discussion. I love hearing sort of what makes modern footballers tick, because it's a bit different to the way it was 10 or 15 years ago. Toby Green, okay? Yep. I feel a bit one out here as a media person. I've been sticking up for him. I covered his tribunal case and it felt like a witch hunt. He was absolutely drilled by the legal counsel, Jeff Gleeson. I felt a bit sorry for him. Not that he shouldn't have been punished. It was a silly thing to do, but the contact was so minor. I listened to the evidence of Matt Stevic saying, to be honest, I didn't think much of it. I just got on with the game. I didn't really know about it until I had a look at it on a mobile phone. And people are calling for 12 weeks and this and that. And what annoys me most about it is this notion that everything Toby does, kids are going to mimic. And it makes the question I have to you, being a former player, does a champion player need to be a role model? Can he just be Toby Green, the footballer, and you pick and choose what bits you want to copy?
It's an interesting question. I think all players are going to be role models, no matter what. And that's not if it's... I think they are. I don't think it's a question that you actually choose to be a role model. I don't think that you actually choose to be one. I think you just are one, and Toby would know he is one. But do I think that this is going to tarnish his reputation with young kids and young fans? No, I don't. Look, obviously he did what he did on the field with the umpire.
It was silly.
That's all. It was silly. And he would say now, yes, it was silly. He's copped his whack. He's going to cop it on the chin. But no one's going to be more disappointed in themselves, not particularly for everything that's gone on, but just because of his teammates and not being out there in a final. So that's really big for him. And I do feel for him in this situation, and also the Giants going forward, because it's a big punishment. If they made the grand final, he'd miss it.
I think there's a bit of lack of footy understanding with people saying 3 weeks isn't enough. 3 weeks at this time of year, if the Giants make the grand final and he isn't there, he will never get over it. And he'll be waking up with sweats in 20 years' time going, my goodness, why did I brush that umpire? It's affected my life. So let's just cut out the needing 8-10 weeks.
And just to give a shout out to Matt Stevic on his honesty as well,
he was
awesome. And by no means are we bashing umpires, because I have the utmost respect for umpires in the game. They do a brilliant job, and totally understand. We love Andre. We love Razor Ray. We love all the umpires, and that's being honest. And I just really respect the way Matt Stevic handled the situation too, and think he did a great job.
Got to get to a break, but final point on this. The other furphy that annoys me is that Toby Green's actions, the trickle-down effect to local footy. So all of a sudden, he's also being pinned with the struggle for umpires in local footy. Well, that's due to crowd abuse. I played a lot of local footy, 15 years of it. I never saw any player touch an umpire. We know the rules. And just because Toby's brushed shoulders with one doesn't mean there's going to be a spate of it around the country in the next few weeks. It's a complete load of crap. I just reckon we need to be mature enough to play every ball on its merits. It was minor contact. It was a little bit of a bad look for the game. Get on with it.
Yeah, well, thoughts? Look, he's copped his right whack. We know you just can't touch umpires now. That's obvious. And do I think that that's going to trickle into local football? No, I don't. People, that, you know, everyone has can work these things out. That it's obviously not what the AFL wants. So I think we cop it, we move on, and we learn from it.
We better move on. No more offensive DMs about Toby Green. We'll park it there. Hey, Mitch Duncan, what a freak. He can kick torps. He can miss about 12 weeks with a PCL and come in and get 33. He's a freak. And he joins us next. Teams on 10 is brought to you by Neds. Take it to the Neds level. Yes, welcome back to Teams on 10. Well, the Cats were a touch flat on the weekend, but there was nothing flat about this man. Mitch Duncan, thank you so much for beaming in again to us on Teams on 10.
G'day, Nick and Dill. How are you?
Good, mate. Firstly, how's the reaction been to a pretty disappointing performance? Has the coach gone the old carrot or the stick? Is he trying to pump you up?
Yeah, we've kind of moved on now. It's obviously 3 or 4 days post-game, and we've only got a couple of days till we play the Giants. So, obviously looking forward a lot more than we are looking back in the past.
Oh, good to hear. Your own form was unbelievable. How do you do that? Miss so much time and just come in and have 33 and dominate?
Well, there's a lot of hard work that goes into it, Nick. But don't know. The boys kicked me the ball a fair amount of times. But I suppose being in the system for a long period of time now, the fitness can come back quite quick. So lucky in that regard.
Rolls Royce last week, Mitch, you were absolutely dominant. But it's fair to say the Giants are in Geelong's head. I think they've won the last two games, and my mates are saying they're looking very confidently for this week. What do you have to say to that?
Mate, you support Geelong anyway, so it doesn't really matter. they have got the wood on us, and we've got a lot of work to do, but that's fine. You know, we're going with great optimism that we can beat them, really confident in our system when we get it right. It's just a matter of getting it right for longer. So, boys are really looking forward to this challenge, and so am I.
No, you're right. The boys are on. Obviously, Hawks 300th last week, and you had Joel Selwood's game this week. 333 games, breaks the club record, which is incredible. Yeah. Quick word on those two. I know how much you love them both.
Yeah, it was disappointing to lose for Hawkey's big 300th, but hopefully we can repay that, winning his 301st and going same with Joel. 333 games is a phenomenal effort on anyone's behalf, but to take over the club record is certainly a high achievement, and I can't really see him stopping.
Hey, Mitchie, a couple of footy ones. Danger's digit, how bad is it, and is he going to be able to get back to his dominant self?
I hope he can. I don't think it's too bad. He did drop a couple of sitters, but we'll give him the week off. And he's dusting himself off, and I'm sure he'll put in a great performance. You know, one of the champion players of the game, and someone that I love running out with every week. And as Joel said, if I'm going to take someone out in a final, it's probably him.
Yeah, well said, Matt. I know you have said you've moved on from the game. Can I just ask you one? The lethargy that seemed to be apparent in the game, was that Port Adelaide's pressure or were the Cats just a little bit off?
Port Adelaide's pressure was, you know, first rate, you know, something that they really pride themselves on, and we have to adjust better. There's no doubt about that. We couldn't get the game on our terms at all for any part of the game, so... you know, it'd be great to come up against him again. Hopefully that's in the last game of September. So, yeah, but a lot of work to be done before then.
Hey, Mitch, obviously the star power at the Cats is well known, but three players I've been loving, Jed Buse, Jack Henry and Mark O'Connor, not sure if he gets up this week. Those three have been unbelievable all year and held down the fort down back especially. How important have they been?
Yeah, they're a couple of your list cloggers.
it's on fire.
For your team, but they've been super. Jack Henry's probably top three in our BNF, to be honest, and was unlucky not to be All Australian in the 40. So, Jed Buse does his job most weeks, really improving on his attacking game. And Mark O'Connor, he kind of can do all types of things, whether it's in the mid or up forwards, down back and covering those dangerous forwards. So, really important members of our side, and unlucky for Mark, he's did his hamstring last week, so won't be available this week.
Hey, Mitch, Jeremy Cameron comes up against his old team for the first time on Friday. Have you detected any nerves in him at all? Is he carrying it around a little bit?
Absolutely not. He is the most relaxed bloke I've ever met. Falls asleep during the day for about 2 hours. I honestly don't know what he does with his time, because all he does is sleep. But hopefully he's awake come Friday night against... GWS, but I'm sure he'll put in a good performance. Proud person, and I'm sure he'll have a few nerves, but that's just all part of it, I reckon.
Yeah, if there's one game he'll get up for, it's this one. I'm very interested to see the matchup with him and Sam Taylor. I reckon that'll be a beauty. Hey, last one, Mitch. I think this is a big year for the Cats, big year for yourself. You've got that horrific premiership tattoo from 2011 on the rib cage. Is this the year that could be added to? And are you going to get another one next to that just to make it as worse?
I thought you'd know a little bit more about me because it's on my hip, not my rib cage. But I do have a shock in my normal rib cage. But I'd love to be able to add to it. Don't get me wrong with another 2021 or something to do with that. But we'll just have to wait and see. But it'll be first thing to do if we do get up.
Hey, you can't give us a bit of an early furphy unbelievable moment and show us the sticker quickly, or is that a bit off?
Oh, it's probably a bit low. A bit low below the belt.
It's a bit low. We'll cut that bit out. On that, Mitch, have you got a nice furfy, unbelievable tale for us?
Well, after a few furfies, my goal seems to be get further and further. And I often say, I remember looking down and seeing the centre wing logo before I kicked it.
This is unbelievable.
It's only about 55.
That's 60 metres. That's 60.
And the coach loved it. Old Scotty was doing his bit in the box. Can I get a little bit more? Is that the best highlight of your career so far? Outside of the granny.
I suppose you always dream of kicking goals after the sign, albeit it was only half time. But yeah, to be able to latch onto one and get one through, especially a torp. I've never kicked a torp goal. So yeah, it's one of my probably better goals.
Mate, you're a freak, and we really appreciate you giving us a bit of your time from the West. Thank you so much for doing it, but you don't go away empty-handed. You get the best prize pack in footy for a second time, so you get the one-year unlimited Wash Club membership thanks to Magic Hand Car Wash. Magic Wash Club is cleaner, safer and faster, and there's 13 locations across Victoria. You get the power drill thanks to Icon Construction, a $50 breakfast voucher at Cheeky Monkey Cafe in Swan Street, one-on-one Pilates from Motion Health, slab of Furphy Refreshing Ale, some bay juice, some Neighbour Cellar Shiraz, and some Smash It hair product for your gorgeous feathers. How good?
Beautiful.
Do I get that helmet too? I'm building a house.
Yeah, I think I still have his drill from last time, actually. I don't think I've actually given him that yet.
Yeah, get it all. You're a star, and go well on Friday night.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
There he is, Mitch Duncan.
Yeah.
You played league footy. He missed, I think it was 12 or 13 weeks, and just rolled in like it was the first game of the year and he had a whole pre-season. What a freak.
No, we joked about that then, but he's genuinely a star. I think he's the cleanest and most like a Rolls-Royce in the comp, the way he goes about it. Missing that much footy, 8 weeks, especially when it's a leg injury too, and comes back and has 33, it makes me sick, to be honest.
And a funny man too.
Very funny.
Just sort
very
of a couple of zingers in your direction. Let's roll into it. It's semi-finals. It starts to get a bit cutthroat.
Hey, brought to us by Magic Ham Car Wash, by the way. May I just say one thing happened yesterday. Dad, I got him one of these for Father's Day last year. And
yes,
I've been in the
Wash
books.
Club.
The Wash Club. I've been in the good books for the last 12 months. If I say anything to the young boys and girls out there, if there is a present to get, it is the Magic Ham Car Wash Club membership. Because dads, they love them. And so do mums.
And the players. The boys love them.
The boys love them. They're red hot.
So thank you to Magic. They've looked after us all year. Righto, Geelong and the Giants in the West on Friday.
Speaking to Mitch there, look, I do love the Cats and I think they'll go well. Without Toby, it's going to be tough for the Giants. This is a big game. It's, oh God, I don't even know what I'm saying here. I think Geelong will win. They play well at Optus.
They were really bad. They looked a touch slow, right? I'm a Cats man, so I'm asking you this question. Can you turn that round? Could that have been a bit psychological rather than running the legs?
They're a mature team. They're a proud team. What they dished up for Tom Walken's 300th game and being Joel Selwood's record-breaking game this week, you can say that milestones don't mean anything. They will be ready to go this week.
I like that. And Brisbane and the Dogs, Saturday night.
Everyone's backing the Lions here, but I think that the momentum last week shifted with the Dogs after beating Essendon. They'd 3 weeks in a row, they'd dropped their game. I think they win this one against the Lions.
Tell me how.
Oh, I just think that the momentum they've got. They've won. Brisbane have the week off. I'm actually not a fan of having a week off as a player, and I think that for the Doggies going in, they'd obviously had the Bont. They've got Dunkley, Treloar in
the
fine
Nort,
form.
The Nort, astronauts flying.
He's
again.
He's in incredible form. And even young Cody Waitman, when you've got player kicking four in his first season, it's pretty impressive.
There we go. Semi-final week. Done and dusted. Teams on 10 style. Hope you enjoyed it. We'll be back next week for the prelims. Yeah.
Oh, my God.